Welcome to the Robert Wenzel Show. Please stand by for Robert Wenzel.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Robert Wenzel Show. I'm Robert Wenzel.
My guest today is Justin Raimondo. He's the editorial director of antiwar.com. If you're not reading Justin at antiwar.com, you're missing out on understanding how the foreign policy world works, what's going on as far as U.S. wars and interventions. I urge you to go over there and read his columns. He puts up about three a week. And his books, if you want to know about Marty Rothbard and his libertarian thinking, Enemy of the State is an excellent book to pick up. Justin, welcome to the show.
Thanks for inviting me.
Let's get right to it. Let's talk about Rand Paul's foreign policy speech. What did you think?
Well, actually, you know, I agree with Robert Kagan, incredibly enough, who writes this morning in the Washington Post that basically Rand Paul's speech was just mush. I can quote from here. He says, despite presenting himself as a brave dissenter from the reigning orthodoxy, Paul and his attempt at an alternative sound remarkably conventional. And that about sums it up. You know, Kagan really takes him apart in a succinct, column, and says, what's his real position? Is he for intervention? Well, he's for it sometimes, but on what basis is not clear. The middle way is always mushy, and Kagan homes in on that.
Yeah, you had a good article on it out today also. I urge everyone to read it. As a matter of fact, on the economicpolicyjournal.com post, where we'll be posting this interview, I'll put a link to this column because I think it's important. But my guess is he trying to attempt to appease two separate groups, the libertarians, two groups that are completely opposite, the libertarians and neocons, at the same time trying to appear anti-war and pro-war?
Well, it's not so much the neocons that he's trying to court, because I think at this point he realizes that they are not about to be charmed, in his charm offensive.
Right.
Their response was quite disdainful. Like Jen Rubin dissed him, and in his earlier attempt to suck up to Commentary Magazine, Jonathan Tobin really put him down. And so every attempt at, building bridges in that direction has failed. But that's not what he's really after. He is after the Christian fundamentalists that he went to Israel with, the American Family Association and that crowd. These are the people that he hopes to win over so that he can win in Iowa and South Carolina. If you look at the primary schedule for the GOP primaries, the presidential primaries, that is the group that he is targeting. And my guess is that it's not going to work. There are many, many applicants for that position as, the champion of the ultra far right in the GOP, i.e. the kooky right, and he's going to wind up like Michelle Bachmann, as a also ran, quickly forgotten. So,
right.
Opportunism doesn't really work. The reason Ron Paul energized so many people and inspired so many people, and the reason he endured all the way to the end of the primaries, was his consistency, his rock-solid principled stand, especially on the question of war and peace. So that inspired people, but mush is not going to inspire people. Being all things to all people just doesn't work.
Right, yeah. Now, how much do you see putting on a psychologist hat for a moment? You talk about patricide in your column.
Well, I meant that in a kind of a metaphorical...
I get that, but I think we saw some of that with George H.W. Bush and George W. Bush, where, George H.W. didn't go all the way into Iraq. We had the Read My Lips, No New Taxes, and George H.W. raised taxes. And then George W. comes along and sort of, quote-unquote, corrects where he thinks his father made mistakes.
Yeah.
Do you buy into that or no? Am I going?
Yeah, you know, I do, you know, to a certain extent, but I tend to be suspicious of, you know, long distance psychologizing.
Right.
I mean, you know, if you were Rand Paul, you know, I mean, people are going to think that he's his father. I mean, like, they are going to look at the ballot and go, oh, Paul. Oh, he's running again? Because most people, unlike you and I, do not follow this very closely. They don't know the difference between Rand and Ron Paul, and they're going to assume that there is none. In fact, most of the Iowa voters, I think, are going to assume it's Ron Paul again. So if you were Rand Paul, you would resent this. I mean, I know I would. So, yeah, you know, I mean, there's probably something to that, but I wouldn't overstate it.
Right. Okay. Let's move on. What do you think President Obama's policy is now? I mean, it seems to me he doesn't like the idea of sending troops in, you know, massive amount of troops, but he'll send in his drones and special operations. What is Obama's foreign policy?
Obama wants to govern the country. That is this country. So what that means is that we can't have any more massive foreign wars. We can have drones attacking here and there. You know, we can help our allies, you know, and lead from behind, as he puts it. I think his agenda is domestic. So what that means is that we are withdrawing, basically, from the post 9/11 rampage. And we don't have the money for it. We don't have the resources. You know, the army is overextended. You know, like deployments are exhausting and enervating our military. And I think he realizes this. You know, the key to understanding this is the appointment of Hagel. I mean, Hagel is, you know, like being put in there to downsize the military, you know, to de-emphasize all of that. And not that they're giving up the empire, but they just want to, you know, like defend their old conquests, you know, like rather than have any new conquests. It's time for retrenchment. That's what's happening with Obama.
Yeah. So now you've been supportive of the Hagel nomination. I mean, do you see that going through? I see we have a delay in the vote. What you're thinking there?
I don't know. I would like to be optimistic, but the neocons know that this is a life and death struggle. If they lose this, then their power is greatly diminished. So they are fighting for their lives. I would not underestimate them. I mean, you know, who knows what new tape they're going to come up with, you know, what new scandal. And they are throwing everything at this guy. And I have to say that hearing was an absolute disgrace. And Hagel's weakness was really imposed on him, from what I hear, by the Obama administration. I mean, they told him not to hit back, and he didn't. And that was a very big mistake. I think they're going to pay for that. So it's not clear. But, of course, the great thing about this is that for us, that is for us anti-interventionists, it's a win-win. If he is actually confirmed, then, of course, that's obviously a victory. But if he's not confirmed, it's still a victory because it'll underscore the tremendous power of the Israel lobby and the neocons and make a point that we've been making for years. And people are going to go, gee, what happened? And then they're going to start to think, well, gee, maybe all those people who were railing about the Israel lobby and its inordinate power were right after all. Maybe John Mearsheimer and Stephen Walt were right in their now famous book, The Israel Lobby, which everyone should read. So this is why I've devoted a lot of time and effort to this, you know, because it really underscores what's wrong with the country and how we can make it right again. So this is a gift to antiwar.com. Thank you, neocons.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about your view of neocons. I mean, are they centered on Israel, or do they have a grander view and think the United States should be the empire?
Yeah, Israel is a side issue. They take advantage of the Israel lobby's apparatus, of course, and their tremendous political weight. But no, I mean, ideologically, it's about the empire. It's about what Bill Kristol called benevolent global hegemony in his famous sort of Reaganite foreign policy, which I think was published in 1998. And in that piece, they actually talk about what their goals are, about what a proper foreign policy for the United States ought to be. And it's basically world domination. I mean, every, you know, like crazy science fiction movie, you know, like which has a mad scientist, and of course, his goal is always to conquer the world, which, of course, back in the 1950s and 60s, you know, was seen as, you know, like proof of your craziness. Well, it's, you know, these days it's not. It's proof of your seriousness. I mean, that's what they want is, you know, a one world government run by them.
Now, they're mostly driven by ideology versus being part of the military industrial complex. Is that the way you would see it? Or
if you look at the career of someone like Richard Pearl, for example, I mean, yeah, sure. You know, like ideologically, he's in favor of, you know, let's conquer the world, let's spread freedom and democracy and, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But you'll notice that he is making or made a kill, you know, in his various investments. And all these people do, you know, it's a very good living for them. You know, it's both.
Yeah. What about Bill Kristol? Have you found any connections between the military industrial complex and his work, what he's doing, or how do you view him?
Bill Kristol's an ideologue, of course. I don't think his, you know, goal is self-enrichment, though I'm sure he wouldn't be opposed to that. But who's funding all this stuff? You know, who's funding his magazine? What, Murdoch? So, yeah, I mean, they have a lot of sources of income, of course. You know, the big neocon foundations. And Paul Gottfried's book, The Conservative Movement, where he chronicles how the five big, once old right foundations were taken over by the neocons. And a tremendous amount of money has been pumped into their various projects. I mean, you'll note that all those TV ads, you know, that appeared against Hegel, I mean, who was funding them? Well, we don't know because, you know, the Citizens United decision means that, you know, Sheldon Adelson, for example, can pour millions of dollars into projects like this. So, you know, the irony is that here we have, you know, the latest delaying tactic by the anti-Hegel forces is Senator Cruz is demanding to know where the money comes from for every group that Hegel has served as an advisor to or even given a speech to and been paid for his trouble. But of course, no one is asking where all this money is coming from for the anti-Hegel campaign. And in their letter to the head of the Senate Armed Services Committee, Carl Levin, they are accusing Hegel of, get this, getting foreign money, which is, I mean, they're getting the foreign money. So this is a case of projection. They are accusing Hegel of what they themselves are guilty of, which is a typical neocon ploy. I mean, Sheldon Adelson is a dual citizen. His wife is an Israeli citizen. So what's up with that?
Right.
It's crazy. Yeah. Full page ads in the New York Times. How many TV ads? I mean, this is just, this brings chutzpah to a new level.
Yeah. You know, talk about the capture of the conservative movement from what the old right was and what happened. How did that change?
Well, what happened is McCarthyism. Murray talks about this in his book, The Betrayal of the American Right, and I talk about it to a certain extent in my own book, Reclaiming the American Right. But what basically happened is that anti-communism took over the conservative movement. Tail Gunner Joe, you know, was up there saying, yes, there are communists in the State Department, and there are communists here, and there are communists there. And soon, you know, conservatives turned their sights on communists abroad. So then rather than fighting the main enemy, which was in Washington, D.C., of course, they turned their sights on, you know, the so-called foreign threat. So if we could hunt down communists on the home front, then why couldn't we do it in, say, Vietnam and, you know, in Cambodia and, you know, Central and South America? So that's what happened. And if you look at the Rand Paul speech, I mean, he signs on to this radical Islam is, you know, a threat, an inherent threat, and is inherently hostile to our country and our interests. This is a perfect example of what happened with the old conservative movement, except now, you know, the new communism is radical Islam. So once you sign on to that, it's a slippery slope, and you slip down it rather quickly. And I think that, you know, we're going to see that in the case of Rand Paul. Like the old McCarthyites of the 1950s and 40s, he is basically accepting the premises of the enemy, and those premises lead to interventionism abroad against radical Islam. So, you know, we'll see how that turns out.
I know domestic policy isn't your specialty, but it really looks like Rand Paul would like to get elected president. And you talk about in your column why that's unlikely to happen. But, I mean, do you see him moving on domestic issues also in the direction of interventionism? Because I don't see how he gets to 50% plus one by just carrying the libertarian banner. Do you have a thought on that?
I don't think that he's going to do that, because the people that he's trying to appeal to aren't going to respond to that. I mean, he's got to differentiate himself from all the other contenders. So if he's the most radical, you know, on domestic policy, then that's going to appease the libertarians, and it's going to impress, you know, the far right people who are, for the most part, good on domestic policy, though that's not always the case, of course. I don't see him selling out on economic issues at all. He's going to be a naysayer, you know, when it comes to more stimulus, more taxes, and he's good on those issues. You know, there's no question about it. It's just that his foreign policy views will undermine that in reality. That is, the state will continue to grow if his foreign policy views are implemented, which they won't be by the Obama administration. The Obama administration is basically withdrawing, you know, and not that they're giving up the empire, as I said before, but we're going to see much less emphasis on this. I mean, you know, I was particularly impressed when I read that Obama had vetoed a crazy plan by the State Department and the Department of Defense to arm the Syrian rebels, and he stopped it, which is great news, because that mm-hmm. would have been an absolute disaster and could lead directly to war with Iran, because, of course, that's what that's all about. They're hoping to lure in, you know, the Iranians and the Iranian Revolutionary Guard in particular into Syria. Syria is their Spain, basically, if you take a World War II analogy. That was the game plan there. It didn't work because the president gotched it, to his credit.
Yeah. Yeah. Getting back to the domestic issues for a moment, I was thinking more along the lines of interventionism to protect us, quote unquote, against the terrorist threat. For example, Rand's TSA policy proposals, if you look at them, I mean, he wants not to eliminate the screening program that's going on by the Homeland Security, but to privatize it. And then secondly, which really scares me, he wants that registration program for people who want to go through the lines quicker, which to me is just government collecting more data and stuff. So he's not going to be in favor of price controls, the minimum wage increases or anything like that, but that, you know, watch out for the terrorists at home could be an area where Rand could not be so good.
Right. If you think that radical Islam is a real problem, and that, like Rand Paul, you think it's not just a very small minority of Muslims, but in fact it is almost a majority, as he says in his speech, then what about American Muslims? I mean,
right.
So, yeah, definitely. He is going to be, I think, shifting his position on that, because Look, it's all about political expediency. That's my theory of foreign policy, which I call libertarian realism, somewhat pretentiously, but there you have it. And in brief, it is that you can explain a country's foreign policy by its internal politics. That is, there's a ruling class, they want to keep their power and expand it, if possible. So that's what determines the foreign policy of a country. They want their power at home preserved and expanded. So if you translate that into, domestic politics, it's the same thing. It's about vote getting. So every position that Rand Paul takes is all about political expediency and keeping his seat in the Senate and running for president. And by the way, this whole Rand Paul president thing is simply a fundraising device. Rand Paul is not going to be elected president. He's not going to be nominated by the Republican Party. This is simply a financial scheme. And to have more money pour into the coffers of their various organizations. And that's what it's all about. And, I hate to be a cynic, but Rand Paul doesn't have a chance of winning the presidency. I mean, first of all, he looks like a teenager. how old is he?
50 years old.
Huh? Interesting.
So
he looks like a child.
Yeah. That's what it's going to do. Let me get you to weigh in. Is that a rug or is that his natural hair? You know, that's been a Roger Stone thing out there. Do you have any thoughts on that? I mean, it's a flippant,
I hadn't even suspected that. And I just heard about it on Twitter like yesterday and I went, what?
Oh, really?
Yeah. So, I hadn't heard that at all. Who knows? Let's ask
Roger Stone. Who cares? Let's go in another direction. And you've written a book about Marty Rothbard. You mentioned him earlier. What kind of guy was he? Why is he important to the libertarian movement? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Murray was important and is important to the libertarian movement because he basically founded the libertarian movement, the modern libertarian movement, in his living room back in the 1960s. And, without Murray, I don't think there would be an independent libertarian movement, at least organizationally. He nurtured the youthful cadre of the movement at a time when people would ask you, what are your politics? And you would say libertarian. And they would say, I didn't know the librarians had their own political movement. I mean, nobody knew what libertarianism was. And so Murray lifted it out of obscurity. And I remember as a teenager who, was getting all these newsletters in the mail and they were all, like mimeographed and stuff. And we were, all very earnest about it. Then one day I picked up the New York Times magazine and there on the cover was a cover story about the youthful rising libertarian movement. And I'm like, wow, this is great. And, it was all about Murray's youthful followers. Of course, I was not a Rothbardian back then. I was a Randian. So that's why he's important. And of course, his published works, he's sort of the Karl Marx of our movement. And also the Lenin. If you look at the last chapter of The Ethics of Liberty, if you haven't read Rothbard, then you basically don't know what libertarianism is. So that's why he's important. As to what kind of a person he was, it's really hard to capture that. But the one thing I remember about his personality most vividly is his laughter. I mean, Murray, once we were at a Libertarian Party convention and we were sitting in the back and somebody said something to Murray, like we were making a joke, and Murray started to laugh. and he could not stop laughing. And we had to carry him out, and he wasn't drunk or anything. We had to carry him out of the banquet hall. Right, yeah. It was during the banquet, and I think Ed Clark was speaking or somebody like that, and he just started laughing and laughing. So we had to take him out. I mean, Murray would pay attention to us, you know, like when nobody else did. I mean, here we were, these snotty little kids, basically teenagers, and he would sit up with us for hours. You know, we all sit around the table at Denny's, his favorite restaurant, and talk for hours. Nobody was more youthful than him. I mean, of course, all of us were many years younger than him, but he was more youthful than we were. And what a sense of humor. You know, it just didn't stop. Murray, boy, do I miss him.
Are you amazed at his output? I hear he slept late. I hear he watched soap operas in the afternoon, that he was a sports fan, that at night he hung out with everybody. And yet he has this incredible output. I mean, it's...
Yeah. What he would do is... In the morning, he would write his more journalistic stuff and his movement stuff, you know, like for the Libertarian Forum or for Inquiry or for, you know, LR. I mean, he wrote really fast. And so he would just churn out these articles during the day. And then at night, he would work on his more serious stuff, the history of economic thought. And plus, he read just... voraciously. Plus, he loved to read. Like, he would pick up anything, you know, like an advertisement and start reading it. And so how he could do all this stuff is beyond me. I mean, I write a column 3 times a week, and each column is about maybe 2,000 words. And that's all I can manage. But, I mean, he could do this with 2 hands tied behind his back and still write the history of economic thought, you know, in his so-called spare time. It was just, and plus he was teaching, right? So, you know, how did he do this? I mean, you know, it's a mystery, but he did it. So there you have it.
Just an incredible man. A good point to end on, Justin. Thank you very much. I really appreciate you taking the time. And everyone, I urge you to go over to antiwar.com. And as Justin said, he's got 3 columns a week he puts up there, and they're all very much well worth reading. Justin, thanks very much.
Thanks for inviting me.
All right, let's bring Chris Rossini on the line for a wrap-up with Rossini. Chris, what did you think?
Justin Raimondo is one of my favorites, and I love talking about foreign policy. The Rand stuff, he hit it right on the head with most people will see him as Ron Paul. So I think it's key what you do here at EPJ, and sometimes I write a few columns, you know, just pointing out that Rand is not his father. He's quite different. He's okay on a few things domestically, but he took a totally different turn foreign policy-wise, and his feet have to be kept to the fire by people like EPJ and Justin Raimondo. And I especially like the Murray Rothbard segment. He's one of my heroes. I've always been fascinated by how a person could accomplish what he did.
Most people would have been satisfied just writing the economic history he did. Most people would have been satisfied with his history of early America and conceived in liberty. And yet, in addition to that, he's written many, many volumes of A History of America's Great Depression, Man, Economy, and State, a History of Banking in the United States, The Ethics of Liberty, Foreign Liberty. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. In addition, in the meantime, he's writing columns all over the place, writing letters to individual people, and meeting with people on a regular basis. Quite a guy, and it was very good to hear Justin talk about that. And also, as far as foreign policy, I could listen to Justin all day. He's a very, very knowledgeable person on what's going on throughout the world and the United States position. So great guy to have on. I could have talked to him for another couple of hours, and we'll have to have him on again.
Yep, I agree.
Okay, that concludes Wrap Up with Rossini. Thanks, Chris. We'll talk to you next week.
Great, thanks again.
Thank you for listening to The Robert Wenzel Show. This is Robert Wenzel. Be sure to check out my website, economicpolicyjournal.com, where I blog 7 days a week about economics, finance, politics, and liberty. Executive producer of the Robert Wenzel Show is Chris Rossini. Head of editing and mastering is John Daubert.